Welcome to the lecture Distributed Data Management in Summer Term 2021 at TU Kaiserslautern. My name is Sebastian Michel. I'm professor at the Department of Computer Science and chair of the Databases and Information Systems Group. So the title of the lecture is Distributed Data Management, and we will go distributed because we want to deal with large amounts of data. And what does it mean, large amounts of data? So here are some numbers. They're already some years old, but they still give you a good understanding what big data really means. So if you're looking in the case of Google, you're talking not about gigabytes, but about petabytes. So we have 15,000 petabytes, which is corresponding to 15 exabytes. Facebook has 300 petabytes, eBay 90 petabytes, and Spotify 10 petabytes. And this is like the estimated data size. Again, has been some years ago already. And in addition, these companies have also data to be processed per day, which is huge. So Google processes every day 100 petabytes, eBay 100 petabytes, and so on. So not only is the amount of data which is stored immense, but also the data processing has to deal with large amounts of data. So how does the data look like in this big data era? It's not only relational data. It is, of course, also relational data to some extent, like we know from database systems, but not only. We have Twitter tweets. We have server access logs within companies that need to be analyzed find intrusions, some attacks. We have web pages, of course, in Google, Bing, and other search engines. And of course, the web graph itself, it's like not HTML, but it's a graph, right? Of pages pointing to other pages. We have large CSV files, so these are also kind of relational, but still not in a format like we know from database systems that can be processed with SQL in a single centralized database system. Here's a sample of some of these data I mentioned. We have a sample of Twitter tweets, like you would obtain when you go into Twitter and you register, and you can access the Twitter data through some API. In this case, you're getting random tweets, random public tweets. And as you can see, this is like in JSON format, for instance. Now imagine you're getting every day such Twitter tweets and you're storing them. You can also, of course, do online analysis. But if you're doing offline analysis after a few days, you will have already several gigabytes of data. And if you're doing this continuously, and not only a simple sample like you're getting through the API, but really going inside Twitter and you have access to all the tweets, these are immense amounts of data. And you have to somehow come up with an algorithm or a framework in order to process this. The big data challenge that comes with the big data is often summarized by four V's: volume, velocity, variety, and variety. And in the recent years, people have come up with additional V's, so five or six V's, but these are the initial famous four V's of the big data challenge. So volume means, of course, that we have lots of data. Velocity means that the data is continuously changing or growing. Variety means that the data is heterogeneous. So we have not only one data format, but multiple. So you have images, videos, text, relational data, graph data, and so on. And last, variety, which means that we are not certain that the data that we have is actually true. So there could be wrong data, missing data. There can be maliciously introduced wrong facts in the data, and so on. So all together, these make up the challenge to work with big data. And we will look in this lecture on the first two points, volume and velocity. So as a showcase to illustrate how difficult it is to work with large amounts of data, let's assume that you have a 10 terabyte disk with a file on it of 10 terabyte size. And you want to do some analysis of it now. And that means you have to read, of course, the data, and then you can do some analysis on it. So let's assume we have a disk, which is not super fast, but it has the right order of magnitude, 100 megabytes per second transfer rate. So we can read at this speed. And when you're reading this 10 terabyte file with 100 megabytes per second, this will take you 27 hours. So this means if you want to do analysis, you have to, of course, do fancier operations and only reading it, but only reading takes you already 27 hours. So you need to do something about it. What can you do? Well, you're buying more disks. You're putting more disks in your server, or you're buying multiple more servers, and then you can read in parallel, and you can circumvent the problem of reading from a single disk takes too long. Here on the left-hand side, you see an image which should display presumably the Google search engine in the year 98 or 99. On the right-hand side, you see a modern data center Google is running with many racks, with many servers. We can, as I said, buy more hardware. And the way that is showcased also on the previous slide on the right side, having a data center of multiple machines, so many racks, many switches, many machines, this is called scale out. So you're doing a horizontal scaling. That means you buy more machines and you put them next to each other, like you can see here. Right? You have independent machines. Of course, they're working together in storage of data and also in the processing, but these are like different machines, right? And you can have hundreds and thousands of these. And depending on the algorithm type and the framework, this scales very well. You can just buy more machines. So if you have more data to analyze and you have the money, you're buying more machines. In contrast to this scale out, there is scale up, also called vertical scaling, where you have one server. And if this is not enough for your task, you're buying more hardware. So you're creating a more powerful server. Of course, this is somehow limited by the power or like the CPUs and the disks and a network connection you can put into a single server. So what you do usually in these aforementioned applications or companies, you're going for scale out. So you go for horizontal scaling and not for vertical scaling. Here's another illustration of a data center. So if you go to Google, you know probably Google Street View, but they have also Google Data Center View, so you can walk through a data center to see how this looks like. So let's assume we went now for a scale-out solution, so we bought more and more machines. What does it mean regarding hardware failures? So we have the assumption in this slide that we have the probability of one machine failing today is 1 divided by 365. That means that one machine fails an expectation once a year. Now, this seems to be like a reasonable assumption. Perhaps it's even less than this, but it's like it has a right, let's say, order of magnitude, one failure on disk or CPU failure per year. So if you have n machines, you can model the probability of a failure of at least one machine, which is given by this equation here, which is easy to be derived. Now, what does it mean if you put in numbers? We see, first of all, for n equal 1, this is not really a problem, right? This is simply this probability. And if you go now higher with n, so for n equals 100, for instance, which is a good assumption for like a small data center or small compute cluster, so we have already the probability of 24% that the administrator has to go and fix some of the machines. And if you go higher for 1,000 machines, we have a 94% probability of a hardware failure. And if you go really high for 10,000 machines, the probability is pretty much 1, so 100%. That means we have to deal with hardware failures every day. Yeah, and this means there is at least one machine, could also be more machines failing. So this means we have to take care of our data center. This is one problem, of course. You have to take care that the machines are running and you have to fix them. But also, if you have to analyze petabytes of data, you're not doing this even if you have 1,000 machines in a time of, let's say, a few seconds. So these are jobs which are running usually longer, minutes or even hours. And if you have now a compute job in this data center of, let's say, 1,000 machines, and this job is running several hours, let's say almost a day, then with a pretty high probability, the job will not be executed entirely because in the meantime, there will be at least one machine failing. So how do you deal with this? Replication. Replication not only in the sense of having a replica of the data, but also when the query execution is happening, that you have machines that can take over a task of a failing machine. Because it fits thematically quite well, I will have put up here on the slide so-called fallacies of distributed computing, according to Peter Deutsch and others at Sun. For instance, you would assume if you have a data center and you set up your network and the machines, that the network is reliable, but it isn't. Latency is zero because it's quick distances and you have 10 gigabit, whatever, connection. But still, there's latency you have to deal with. You don't have infinite bandwidth and so on. But this is like only an overview to make you aware that if you're going distributed, there are, of course, additional aspects to be considered compared to centralized computing. So you have to take care of failures. So they can happen any time. And the algorithms and infrastructures have to compensate that. I mentioned earlier, or a few slides ago, if you're having long-running jobs, you pretty much can be sure that there will be some kind of failure during the execution. So you have to make sure that the entire computation is not wasted and you have to start again. Because if you're starting again it might fail, right? So this is not a solution to start over and over again. In order to understand how costly it is to do distributed computing, here you see a slide by numbers or numbers by Jeff Dean. And you have seen this slide probably before in the database systems course, where we look mainly at the difference between memory reference and disk time. But here in addition, you have, well, what is important now also in the course is to look at network traffic, how expensive it is. And here you see, for instance, that is that you have a round trip, so the data sending from one to the other in a data center costs 500,000 nanoseconds. So this is cheaper than a disk seek that you know from a database systems course, but it's still like kind of expensive compared to, of course, memory references. If you're sending 2 kilobyte over 1 gigabit network, this takes then 20 nanoseconds, and this is kind of course, a factor of order of magnitude cheaper than having a round trip within the same data center. If you have, you want to read 1 megabyte sequentially from a network, let's say this costs like 10 million nanoseconds, which is the same as a disk seek time, right? So you're understanding kind of the different order of magnitudes for the access time. And these numbers are, of course, important when you're designing algorithms, that you're not doing fine granular access on the disk, and you should also not do that in a network because it always comes with latency issues. So let's go on and have a look what that means. So in this lecture, you will learn some fundamental concepts of processing big data. First of all, we will look at MapReduce. This is a bit oldish, a framework for making distributed computation in data centers. This was invented in a paper or described in a paper in 2004, published by members of Google. But still, the underlying concept of shuffling data around and doing aggregation is still valid. And it's also easy to see what's going on if you're looking at MapReduce rather than one of these fancier or more modern frameworks like Spark. We will look at NoSQL systems and also on cloud computing in a bit shallow way, but in NoSQL specifically, we will go quite deep also in replica and consistency guarantees. We will operate on state-of-the-art research results and tools. In particular, we will look at MapReduce and also Spark. So this lecture is kind of a middle way between pure theory and also doing something practical in terms of algorithms and systems. Also, we have, as I mentioned, there's some theoretic aspects. We have some standalone, important and highly influential pieces here that we consider, like consistent hashing, PageRank computation, and Bloom filters, which are by themselves important algorithms to know. So the lecture contents are, I mentioned already the keyword MapReduce and also Spark. We will look at fundamentals and then algorithms on top. NoSQL approaches, in particular key value stores and the theory behind, like the CAP theorem and Bayes, which is like the contrast to ACID that you know from database systems. We will look at distributed data stream processing and also cloud computing and big data in general, but not that detailedly. So what do you need to know in order to successfully participate in this course? Well, you should have attended the database lectures, ideally both that we are offering, the undercredited one, information systems. Everyone should know anyway from any university, I guess, there is such a course. And ideally also the database systems course that we have organized and we give every winter term. So you should be well prepared. We will not revisit such fundamental things here. For the exercises, it's important also to know some programming languages and also standard mathematics and other computer science things will be relevant for the understanding of this course and also for the exercises, of course. So we will indeed, when I mentioned Java, Scala, C++, we will indeed require you to dive into APIs of MapReduce and Spark. And also, if you're not using our virtual machine that we provide, you also have to see how you're installing these frameworks on your machines in order to run the exercise solutions, right? I mean, when you're developing the solution, you want to test it, of course, so you need to run it. So this is non-trivial. Don't underestimate the time it takes to get into these frameworks. But I think it's a very worthwhile effort, so you will learn really something fundamental here. Yeah, so I have already introduced myself, but of course I'm not running this course alone. Damian Gurowski, PhD student in my group, will take care of the exercises and also run the exercise session. We are reachable by email, MetaMost and OLAD. And the offices here, unfortunately, won't really work well because of Corona. We are also mainly in home office. So a few words on organization and regulations. The lecture is held by providing videos, pretty much like I would also do in a normal lecture. Questions are handled via MetaMost and OLAD. We can arrange a fixed weekly consultation hour if you want. The past two semesters have shown that there's barely any interaction going on. It seems that the students prefer, or you prefer more, like you can ask questions anytime, and we, whenever we look in MetaMost and OLAD, answer these throughout the week. So there's no need to wait for this one fixed hour, but if there's interest, we can do that. I don't mind. Exercise session will be held online. The link will be shared later on. It's happening on Thursday, bi-weekly, and from 10 a.m. to 11:30. First session, May 13th. There will be exercises, hence we also have the exercise session, of course. There will be an assignment sheet every 2 weeks. We have a mixture of practical assignments and a bit theory. Perhaps you need to also investigate certain properties of systems and write a few sentences about it. And you need to successfully participate in order to get admitted to the final exam. So here are the regulations for exam admission. There will be 6 exercise sheets. Each sheet has 3 mandatory assignments. You can solve these assignments in groups of 2 maximum. Upload a solution and mark which of these assignments you have completed. Every mark you're putting is equivalent to 1 point, but of course the TA, Damian Gyorski, he will look at your solution and deduct the point if the answer was not appropriate. Of course, if you're copying solutions from other groups, then both groups will be disqualified. And if you're also copying solutions from previous year solutions, and we notice this, then also this leads to immediate disqualification, and we would not even argue then. So 6 sheets, 3 assignments each makes 18, and we require that you obtain 13 points or more to get admitted to the exam. If the solution is pretty much correct or close to it, and you have marked this assignment to be done, then you're getting the full point. If you have marked it, but the solution is not sufficient, then there will be 0 points on this assignment. And there's also the special case of having 0 points on the entire sheet. This will be given if you're marking an assignment that you claim you did it, but obviously you did not. And we take this as a cheating attempt. About the exam, in the end of the teaching period, there will be oral exams or written exam. And I would like to postpone the decision a few more weeks because if it's not so many participants, then we can have an oral exam. But the fallback is always to have a written exam because then it's easier to deal with many participants, which is of course good to have many participants. I'm not saying I prefer oral over written, but some of you might prefer oral exams. So if so I would like to postpone this decision. I will let you know as soon as possible. Everything mentioned in the lecture and exercises is mandatory, I mean relevant for the exam, unless explicitly stated. And this means that it has to be stated basically by me in the videos or by the DTA in the DTA session. He would do this checking with me, of course, when we rule out some topics, but I would not even be aware which one that would be, which topics. So pretty much everything is relevant. And we assume active participation in the exercises so that you're well prepared. Usually the first exam, the exam period, would be pretty much after the end of the teaching period. And then later on again in fall, so we have fixed like exam dates, let's say, or oral exam weeks. And in particular for the first one, if you did not really follow this course intensively, it's difficult to catch up if only a few days or a week time. So the semester is 14 weeks long, and it's also the purpose of the semester that you're preparing for the courses and not keeping, let's say, being a bit more relaxed during the semester and then like freaking out when the exam comes. So it should be like a continuous process, basically. Of course, a bit more intense when the exam comes, but you should really spend some time throughout the semester already understanding the concepts. I mean, obviously, right? I mean, this is like a master course. You should not have heard this and you should know this, but I'm just saying this in addition. In order to participate in the course and the exercises, you need to register in OLAT. I guess most of you did this already. There's also the link to the videos. I would be surprised if you got the video without that OLAT registration. But anyway, you need to do this and then enroll in groups. There will be also some announcement describing how you're doing this in detail later on. And without OLAT registration, you cannot participate in the exercises. Hence, you cannot participate in the exam. So the topic on NoSQL systems and also on MapReduce and distributed system concepts can be summarized by a few books. Here we have in particular at the bottom here some very known books on distributed systems and distributed algorithms, and then some more practical guide to Hadoop, MapReduce. Hadoop is one MapReduce implementation. There are multiple, in particular the one from Google, the initial one, but then also re-implementations in case for Hadoop. And then you have some other books. This one here is in German, but here and this one are also English books talking about NoSQL. And in addition on these pretty like applied, let's say, books, next to the theoretic ones on distributed systems, there are of course also relevant topics in the standard books on database systems. Like for instance here this one, El Mastri and Navate, Fundamentals of Database Systems, or here like the known one by Garcia Molina, Almen and Whittem, Database Systems. So there is plenty of literature available also in the library on these topics, and online you can consult if you have to read up on some of these more standard topics. There's also more specific literature when we go for individual topics, but then I will point to the original research articles mainly, and some of them are really interesting and easy to understand, some years old or more modern ones. This is always a good idea to also read up on these scientific papers beyond the normal books.